Hello and welcome to LFC Focus. It is post-match reaction showtime after Liverpool have just lost against Atalanta at home in the Champions League in what's probably the most boring game I think any of us are ever going to see in our lives. And to be honest, if anything, I'm almost glad that Atalanta won the game because at least someone got something out of it. You know, if that had ended 0-0, then everyone will have walked away thinking, what a waste of everyone's time. But at least they get to go home and be happy, and it has spiced up the group. It certainly prevented anything that boring, hopefully fingers crossed, from happening when we play Ajax at home in a week's time, because suddenly the situation, well, it's not been turned on its head. Liverpool are still ahead in the group. It's still very much in their hands. But you're now looking at it and thinking somehow Liverpool might find a way to yet again make the group stage campaign go down to the last day, because not only have we allowed Atalanta to gain ground on us, we've also given Ajax an added impetus next week because they go into that game knowing that they haven't gained any ground on Atalanta. They're both now on 7 points, and with Atalanta playing Midtjylland next week, Ajax kind of need to win. It's not definite. They can still lose that game and then beat Atalanta in the final match, and they will go through regardless of what Atalanta do against Midtjylland before that. But they now come to Anfield also having seen that Liverpool are there to be got at, that Liverpool can be beaten at home in Europe. And up until recently, that just wasn't the case under Jurgen Klopp. That didn't happen under any circumstances. And even the loss against Atletico, you can kind of write it off in a way because it was down to an individual error or multiple individual errors from a fella, Adrian, who's rarely in the team. Whereas this was a case of just the entire Liverpool team from top to bottom, and the subs that came on later on in the game as well, just looking so far off the pace. You know, Liverpool can play badly and you can make your peace with that, but when we come out like that and we don't even have a shot on target, and we very much just spend 90 minutes passing the ball around, occasionally giving it away, and then walking off after 90 minutes having lost 2-0, that is kind of worrying. And if there's one thing that won't cheer you up but will certainly allow you to justify what's happened tonight in your own mind, it's the fact that in a way it's kind of been coming. This team has been being run into the ground for weeks and weeks now. That's what this entire season has been about, is just relentless games, and something was going to have to give. I know we've had difficult performances and results, obviously, like the loss to Aston Villa, and maybe the second half against Man City where we started to run out of gas, but that was also informed by the first half of the game. But it certainly feels like after this international break we've just had, and with the way the fixtures are being scheduled, Sunday night, Wednesday night, Saturday afternoon after this as well, you know, this wasn't the nadir. It's only going to get worse from here in terms of how Liverpool are just going to have to run players into the ground through game after game, because we quite simply haven't got the options. The lads were bad tonight. They were clearly off it. They clearly didn't have the energy for a 90-minute football match against another team who've qualified for a competition as prestigious as the Champions League. But we haven't got replacements for them at the moment. Maybe Henderson and Thiago come back at the weekend, and hopefully, fingers crossed, Trent Alexander-Arnold is back sooner rather than later in the side. But apart from those, the lads who played tonight, broadly speaking, you know, Gini Wijnaldum, Fabinho coming on, Joel Matip playing most of the game, those lads who look absolutely shattered are probably going to have to play again at the weekend. The same goes for Milner and Curtis Jones as well. I almost didn't mention them there because they were kind of anonymous in a way, and I don't want to sound like I'm criticising them too much because they're good footballers. I'm not saying they're bad. I'm not saying they were bad at football tonight, if that makes sense. I'm just saying the lads didn't have it in them. They didn't have that extra yard. Time and time again, passes were getting cut out because there was just a few yards off it. There was, you know, it was slightly weaker than it needed to be. There wasn't the power necessary to reach the player, or it was going astray because a player needed to step forward to get to it and they didn't have the energy or the impetus for that. And time again, Atalanta players were pouncing on that. They were doing what Liverpool normally do. Normally it's us who wear teams down, who make them run themselves into the ground trying to defend against us, and then in the later stage of the game, we pick them off in the way that Atalanta did today. But as the game wore on today, it just got worse and worse. And once Liverpool needed two goals just to get any kind of result out of the game, I mean, we never looked like doing that. It wasn't just the fact that we didn't manage a single shot on target. We weren't even getting in the box. We weren't getting near the box. Whenever we got into vaguely threatening positions, Atalanta cut it out with what looked like relative ease, and it's kind of difficult to know how much to credit them with, because we know they can be a great footballing side. Obviously, it didn't fall their way when we played them in Bergamo, and we obviously trashed them 5-0, and I think Liverpool played very well in that game as well, so it's maybe difficult to assess how bad necessarily Atalanta were. But tonight, I think they were good. They were certainly a hell of a lot better than Liverpool, but that, I think, is almost just down to the fact that they looked fitter, they looked sharper, they maybe looked like they wanted it a little bit more as well. I know Liverpool are going into this game, and like I said, when the players haven't got that energy, we've seen maybe towards the end of seasons when everything's on the line, looking back to like the run-in in 2019 where we had like endless Premier League matches that were all must-win games, and then in the middle of that we also had to overturn a 3-goal deficit against Barcelona, and despite the fact the games were just coming relentlessly at that point, Liverpool somehow managed to get the job done. They found a way around that difficult situation because they knew they could just run themselves into the ground for a couple of matches and then that would be it and they'd be fine. But we haven't got that luxury now. If the players wear themselves out and they're all pushing themselves into a red zone where they are risking injury now, then they're going to pick up injuries because it doesn't stop. It is simply relentless. There isn't even an international break where Jurgen Klopp can say, you know what, I've had enough here, I'm pulling you all out of international duty, I'm not allowing you to go away with your respective nations. And I'm sure if there was an international break next week, for example, he might have to take that kind of drastic action, and he might have to do that because it is getting to breaking point. And like I said, I don't necessarily want to criticise individual players, because at the end of the day, it's not like they were bad at football. They just didn't have the energy to play football to their usual standards. I think a couple of players maybe did stand out as just not being very good tonight. Divock Origi being one of them. That's kind of the big elephant in the room at the moment. He just quite simply was useless. I'm not saying that in a mean or derogatory way. I'm just saying Liverpool have not got a use for Divock Origi now. He's on the pitch and you've got no idea what he's supposed to be doing. When Firmino plays in between Salah and Mane, he does so many things and it seems that he knows how to do them. He knows why he's there. He knows what his role is on the pitch to get the best out of everyone else. Divock Origi is not getting the best out of Divock Origi, let alone anyone else on the pitch. And, you know, Jurgen must know this, because I can't see a scenario where he's tearing it up in training every single day and it just so happens that when he gets out on the pitch, it doesn't fall for him or anything like that. It is so, so clear to absolutely anybody that he doesn't suit this Liverpool team anymore. And listen, he's not a bad footballer. Again, I don't want to criticise players and say they're bad footballers, because they play for Liverpool and all of them have done brilliant things for Liverpool in the past, Divock Origi included. But the team we are now is just a world away from any kind of team that he should be playing in. You know, you look back to the very early stages of Klopp, and Divock Origi was almost seen as the kind of archetypal player that Jurgen Klopp could maybe build his attack around. He seemed to prefer Origi over Sturridge. He seemed like more of a system player, someone that Jurgen really, really liked. But Jurgen's changed his system and things have changed, things have adapted. And Divock Origi is almost like Nathaniel Clyne, to use another example from recent years at Liverpool. A player who is good and was good for us in the past, but it's just not happening for him anymore. And the team has left him behind almost. You know, he's not Roberto Firmino. He's not Diogo Jota either. And listen, I know Minamino hasn't been brilliant so far this season and barely even got a sniff tonight, although the game was dead and buried and a complete waste of time before he even started warming up, I think. But at least I think with Minamino, there's potential there. You think if you put him in that lineup tonight, for example, I would have loved to have seen him play centre forward. And it does kind of beg the question of what Jurgen Klopp was up to. Maybe he's looking at this game almost as a free hit. He knows that we've got a little bit of wiggle room in the Champions League that we haven't got in the Premier League at the moment, because we did have that big points lead that has now been cut down ever so slightly. But maybe he wants to have a look at Divock Origi, and maybe tonight was the last chance saloon. Maybe tonight was the last chance for Divock Origi to show that he can gel with the rest of this Liverpool side. If so, it's a bit harsh on him, because this Liverpool side, as I've said already, was nowhere near what it can be. But the signs have been there for a while now that Divock Origi is not what he once was. And I think it is best for all parties that he moves on, because in the past, he was a player that even if he didn't play well, we could rely on him to provide moments that switch games around. And you look at a match like tonight and think, well, maybe Origi didn't play well, but he maybe Liverpool win 2-0 and he gets one of the goals and it turns out he made an important contribution in that regard at least. But that's not happening anymore. And I just think when you've got other players like Minamino who is available and can play, and Diogo Jota who's coming in now and is just as good as kind of any other member of the front three, Divock Origi just seems a world away from the other options at Liverpool at the moment. And I think tonight certainly solidified that, because any attack that got as that did get far enough to him, and to be honest, not many of them did, got absolutely nowhere after that. And it was pretty damning, if we're being perfectly honest. But like I said, it feels harsh to criticise anyone tonight, because we know why Liverpool played badly. And hopefully tonight doesn't get written off. Hopefully it doesn't get put to the wayside, and it's acknowledged that Liverpool have been pushed too far, and this will happen to other teams as well. Other teams will not be able to push themselves constantly through barrier after barrier all the way through the season. Everyone's going to hit a breaking point at some point. Liverpool's has maybe come slightly earlier because of a few really key injuries that have hit us in very, very important areas, and as a result, other players have played more than they maybe would have liked. But as we approach this Christmas period now, this isn't even technically the worst bit of the season. I know it's a different season and things have been more congested, but December is by and large where you face your toughest tests, both in terms of, you know, getting results on the pitch and also in terms of getting every player out alive. And listen, let's end on a positive. Liverpool didn't get any injuries tonight, which at the moment feels like an absolute godsend and almost feels like a win in itself. I think if you're going to lose the match, at least we didn't, at least no one got a pointless injury that came out of a game that we didn't even gain anything from in the first place. And listen, it might change. You know, we could get scans come through over the next couple of days. We know players like Joel Matip can pick up these kind of little knocks that keep them out for a couple of weeks that you never notice until afterwards when he starts to complain of a little bit of discomfort and stuff like that. So fingers crossed and touching wood and everything like that for the next few days. And of course the match against Brighton at the weekend, where Liverpool are quite simply going to have to be better. And to be honest, I don't really know how that happens. I don't know what you do to these players and to this team to make them better, because it doesn't matter what you do tactics wise or player psychology wise, they're still shattered. They're still absolutely done in. And like I said, something's got to give at some point, and hopefully it gives soon. Hopefully there's more coordination and a bit more sensibility around how the fixtures are scheduled to make sure we don't have a 7-day period where Liverpool are playing 3 matches. But for now, we just got to get through this. And that starts with Brighton at the weekend. And then it really does start as well with the game against Ajax in a week's time, which suddenly has a hell of a lot of significance, because as I said, it would be typical Liverpool to make this go down to the last day once again. But I'm pretty sure, I think mathematically, we do still have the opportunity there if we were to beat Ajax at home to secure qualification to the Champions League knockout. So the result itself, not that disappointed. The performance, worrying. What it means for the future, potentially concerning. But as we know with this Liverpool side, when the going gets tough, Jurgen Klopp's boys gets going. So fingers crossed, everything will turn out all right in the end. But until then, that is all for today's video. Thank you guys very, very much for watching. If you did enjoy the video, then do hit the like button down there. Hit that subscribe button there if you're new around here. Check out some of the other videos that have been out on the channel over the past few days. Don't forget to follow at LFC Focus TV on Twitter. And I'll be back on Friday afternoon with the pre-match content for the game against Brighton. Until then, bye for now.